The first base is located near the defender's spawn point, and the second is at the bottom of the hill. Sometimes teams split their forces and send several tanks through the 1-2 line to the left of the small hill, but usually both teams play at the center. The attacking team can send one of the tanks up to the lighthouse or behind it. Fast and quick-firing vehicles are better suited for this map, mainly medium tanks, including tanks equipped with autoloaders.
And right out of the gate, we have two very even lineups, with 07 bringing four bat chats, a TVP, two tier 9 bat chats. Meanwhile, High bringing five bat chats, a TVP, and an RU-251.
The map of autoloaders, they call it.
Yep, and just like that, Blue Mini heading towards the middle. Allie the Persian dude and the rest of his team coming up there. Meanwhile, TVP squaring off in the south for High. The tier 9 bat chat down low, just keeping some eyes there. And the rest of 07 are actually going to be heading towards
and
the middle.
And I just noticed Blue Mini actually changed his shell type. He was reloaded. He was about to be reloaded, and they changed his shell type. So I'm not quite sure what he was loading and then what he actually switched to.
That is rather interesting. So that being said, both teams kind of playing it slow, something I didn't necessarily foresee out of either of these teams.
No, I mean, Cliff, like you said earlier, is a map that we kind of know the winner within the first 2 minutes of the game. Or minutes sometimes.
Yeah, but these teams opting to play slow. They did get Fosta up into that A5 boost up there. Warbander kind of working on the hill. They do have their tier 9 bat chat down in the south over there. Well, not in the south, but over in the west in the low ground. Seeing where the D2 just keeping vision down there, that TVP hasn't been spotted yet, and there are 251s backing him up. So High do need to find a way in here, though. I do like what they're doing. If you are going to slow play, this is the way to do it. You get some 3-line control, but a majority of your control is sitting right around the 5-6 line in the middle there. If you can't have some sort of control in the middle of this map, it's very hard to make a move towards either cap. And so the fact that they're dug in here, they have the intel that they need, is bodes very well for them in the long run.
And already we've pretty much passed the point of what we normally see, at least one to two tanks down per team. Fulcris, as I say that, taking quite a bit of damage, healthy damage, I would say,
yep.
For Team 07.
Yep, Fosta fired two shots once he realized he no longer had a shot. He dropped the remaining two in his drum.
And again, very healthy damage in favor of 07.
Yep, so, and that's something I've talked about before, is just managing clips in the autoloader, both in organized play and just in your own pub match for the more casual players out there watching right now. Make sure that you, when you're not engaged, you back out and you get a full clip in there. So often you'll see players that'll fire off a couple shots in, say, a bat chat, and they'll only have two or three left, but they decide not to drop it because they know they won't have shots for a while, and they kind of just float around, and they may even completely flex to their side of the map and not have shots. So make sure that you
start finding a shot on my coast. They're nice.
So just make sure that you reload when you can and you have the opportunity. And if you need to wait a second to make a play, you need to just drop back and not force as early as you want to, then take the extra second. Make sure you have all of the shots. Very rarely is it so time sensitive that you can't wait to reload and that your two shots of damage have to be in there.
Oh, here we go. A little fight going on. Romstar is overmatched and he should fall here literally and figuratively. This is coming, but Blue Mini, here he comes to clean up the mess. Damage coming on the static now. He should go down in a second. Fulcris gonna live. And High still find themselves in the HP pool disadvantage, though, although they are guns up. Well, a gun up, I should say. A tank up.
Fosta firing off his last shot in his drum, reloading. Meanwhile, Exo dueling around with Ali the Persian dude up on the hill.
Almost fell a little too hastily. Tanks destroyed. That is supposed to be damage done, but man, he has destroyed 112,000 tanks this season so far. That is a pretty disgusting number.
It's actually 12,000 damage in fifth place that he's done so far this season, or 112,000, yeah. Excuse me.
Right.
So not bad there out of him so far this season. Meanwhile, he's still going around with Exo. Exo only has two shots left. And now the person that's been counting.
Will this last one roll high? It leaves him with a little bit of HP, and now Exo is in trouble.
Fosta will be covering
him from
a distance.
In the background, Fulcris is going to go down, but here he comes. One more shot. Can he take out Exo? This would be huge, and he does. Relinquishing control. Ali is going to stay in control of that hill as he's slowly starting to go down.
He's trying to climb along the backside.
Okay. Intelligent decision. Obviously, he doesn't want to take shots from anyone. Oh, as I say intelligent. Ali the Persian, dude.
I normally wouldn't say it, but let's get some Fs in chat going there for Ali. Pay your respects. Meanwhile, 07's still looking good this round. Very solid crossfire they have going here. The TVP just chilling out up at A5. Bat chat's in the middle there at E6, all where they can cover each other and just Makos in that one bat chat. However, he is going to take some damage. They will find some shots onto Permatrash. Will he go down?
Permatrash is actually going to pick up Makos.
He does get Makos. However, it didn't. It comes at 17,000 HP of HP they just threw away.
Oh, it's an expensive tank, yeah.
Yeah, so almost a tank for a tank there. One shot of damage was the difference in the long
run. Blue Mini trying to work this tier 9 bat shot. He has to be very careful, though, because he could potentially go down in just two more shots. 1-2. Permatrash is also one shot away from death. Blue Mini is running away from Fossils. He's trying to find shots, and it is now three tanks alive.
The combined HP for high right now
is less than 100.
76.
So would you say that the HP pool lead is in favor of 07?
Yeah, you could say that. I mean, seeing as 07 or Fossa could kill all of them with one clip and then still have a shot to spare, it kind of says a lot right there. Meanwhile, Commodore does have a dead driver, so something to keep an eye on over there. But once again, 07 are defending. They don't have to do anything. They can just chill out here. It's up to High to make a play with their 76 HP points they have left.
Here's the thing. Had Ali not suicided off the top of the donut
still
there,
would have been close to less than 100 damage.
No, but the point is he would have been a threat up there.
Once he had dropped down where he was simply just trying to get out of there. You can't get back up on the hill from there. So he was kind of stuck trying to get out of there without killing himself. However,
he killed himself.
Didn't work out for him.
Shots being found on the Commodore, though. I mean, okay, look, it's not impossible. It's just highly improbable that High would make this comeback.
There goes one.
Yep.
So, yeah, and at this point, and look at this. Two tanks left alive, 23 HP between two of them. Kind of ridiculous, but that's what RNG says sometimes. So, Blue Mini on HP, Magenta Panda on 15 HP. And Blue's just hoping to get a pick. All they could hope for is some free early damage.
I'm going to be honest. These tanks here from 07 could be firing Skittles, and they would still do enough damage to take out the tanks of High.
Pretty much. Fosta just looking in the north. They know they don't have to go anywhere. He can very quickly flex towards the south and cover Magenta. Well, not cover Magenta, but cover Warbander and Commodore. Magenta Panda just chilling out there. Blue Mini also. And at this point, they're just kind of waiting for things to slow down. Maybe see if 07 kind of make a mistake. They get impatient.
And it doesn't look like 07 is going to make that mistake. Again, after their game against Eclipse, I would imagine that's a decent confidence booster.
Yeah, they played very well on that match overall. They had some very good rounds. They had some rounds that weren't so good, but overall, most of the rounds...
Sure, and Meadow did allude to that as well. He's like, we played great, and we also made mistakes that we weren't proud of, but hey, overall, they're playing well now.
Yep, so we'll have to see what they can do going into the rest of these battles. However, this one looks like it will be going in favor of himself.
Yeah, and this is even that slower playstyle that you alluded to that you gave High the advantage for, and here they are, 07, doing very well with it.
Certainly, and Blue Mini just looking for some shots. Warbander just making sure there's no sudden push coming out of High. Only a minute left, so we'll have to see if High even make a play. They maybe just be sitting here talking about what strats they're going to run next.
Yeah, either way, I mean, this, sure, they've lost the first battle, but hey, like you said, High can talk about a lot right now. They are winding down the clock. Obviously, they haven't come out to suicide. They've just been stationary, and this is a great time to be talking about strategy. Or about their favorite TV shows. I don't know. I'm not in comms.
sometimes as a caller when you're in these sort of situations where there's just nothing going on, sometimes some of your players just start getting impatient. They want to go do stuff, and you just have to remember where,
well, let's go,
you know,
do stuff.
Yeah, well, they want to go find something to kill. You know, sitting around. You know, I don't think anyone's going to say that sitting around in the same spot is entertaining. So, you know, they kind of just, you know, they get trigger happy. They say, all right, we want to go off and do stuff. And sometimes as a caller, you just kind of have to slow it down. Go, guys, like, just one more minute. Burn it out. It's a free win. Let's not even risk it. There is that small chance that they could claw into it. So let's just not even give it anything. Let's just play it to our advantage right now. Slow it down.
That was textbook by 07.
Yep, just killing out a round.
Very nice.
So they sat there. They knew they didn't have to make a play. They had a huge HP lead. You know, when you have two tanks with 23 HP, there's not really a whole lot you can do. So at that point, it's just a matter of buying time, whether it's speed to talk about strats or slow it down. You know, may never know, but we'll have to see.
07, going to take the first game. Very nicely done. And again, on a map of Cliff where we expect brawls just 24/7.
It's a very hard crossfire to break, especially with that many autoloaders. When you get into those positions, you get fossed up at A5. And they had a lot of control even out towards the 3 line. They had some tanks sitting passive in some bushes there. And they're very hard to dig out. And they were just able to just kind of slow it down and make High just get punished for every play they wanted to make. Even Ellie the Persian dude, for that trade, the only thing that kept him alive was the fact that he was counting shells from Exo. He understood that he only had 2 shells left. He took a little bit of a gamble there. If he had high rolled, he might have gone down, but got lucky with the rolls, stayed alive.
It's going to be Blue Mini here doing the most damage for his team, and that is, I say that as something that's slightly odd, not because Blue Mini can't, you know, aim or he can't usually put out good damage or damage farm. It's just because he's always in the tier 8 light position.
Yep.
So being on Cliff, you know, he is obviously most likely not going to play that role.
Yep. So far tonight, they've moved Romstar into the tier 8, which is something we did see a
lot
last
day. We have
seen
that before, correct.
But, you know, looking over at 07, they have Commodore in that tier 9 bat, and they also had last round, pulling it up here, they also had Static in the tier 9 bat chat. Both of them doing all right. No, nothing crazy as far as damage goes out of either team.
No.
I will say, you know, a lot of very even damage across 07, 1100, 1100, 1100, 1200, and 2300. So a little bit of an outlier there at the end, but overall pretty consistent out of them. And, you know, that's, you know, just playing it safe, essentially. They got a very good crossfire going. They got some good early picks. They kind of baited Static a little bit. They made sure to trade him out. And once they had that sort of advantage, it just came down to individual duels. Ellie up on the hill versus Exo. Just a lot of different little things.
Yeah.
And they all kind of worked out in favor of 07.
Exactly like you said, a lot of little things just worked out. So I'm curious to see how High is now going to play defense now that we just saw 07 on offensive Cliff. Dare I say we might have a brawl this time or not? I don't know.
I hope so.
Like you said, Hyde tends to be a little bit of a slower player, but we'll see.
Yeah, no, 07 tend to be very aggressive, especially when they're on offense. So we'll have to see if we see that out of them right now. Looking at this lineup, so I don't see anything that would say that we're going to see anything other than aggression. However, if you had asked me last round, I probably would have said the same thing. These lineups are capable of playing it slow when they need to. When you have that much burst, if you set up in those sort of crossfires, if anyone wants to push through it,
but
all
again,
those
I mean, this is a map where we see all autoloaders, a couple TVPs, but usually just all bat chats or tier 9 bat chats. That's what it is. Some teams, like we just saw with Rom, do tend to favor still a tier 8 light, but I don't know. We'll have to see.
Well, it has to do with these teams that tend to fight over the middle a lot. It's just one long lane where most of the shots are exchanged right there in the middle. And so these autoloaders are favored because when you put them in this sort of crossfire position, they can be so much damage.
Really?
Pump
so
out.
Actually, out of 07, we're going to see a 113 and a grill.
And then 3 bat chats and 2 tier 9 bat chats. Meanwhile, High coming in with a 113 of their own. And those were actually backwards, I believe. High bringing the 113 and the grill. Meanwhile, 07 bringing 2 TVPs, 3 bat chats, and 2 tier 9 bats. So a little bit mixed up there. However, it is indeed High on the defense.
Thanks. I was
going to
say,
grill
on this map, I mean, bringing a grill isn't unheard of for defense, but for offense, that would have been a little different. And it looks like we are not going to see just a straight-up brawl. We are definitely going to see Static and Feel My Potato spotting each other. But not much else. It's going to be another, looks like, slow Cliffs.
Yep, and it's going to be 07. They're actually going to take the hill. Meanwhile, Fasta just chilling out here in the bush. That has good vision out towards the three line. Kind of just sitting there passive. He doesn't really have to worry about a whole lot. However, he is spotted right now, actually.
Now, shots coming out on Warbender. Feel My Potato is making every single one of those count. One more shot. And he's actually going to... Oh! Fasta tagging him before Feel My Potato goes down. And Warbender left with peanuts as far as HP is concerned.
Still has more HP than all of Hyde did at the end of last round.
That's, I mean, that is true, yes.
And there is a really interesting game being played up on the hill almost at this point with these bat chats just hanging out here. Makos also up there, and they're just trying to pin back what they can. They do have an idea that Fulcrus is sitting back there in that grill, so they're just blind firing those bushes as best they can, hoping to maybe catch him out. Static's actually looking for some more shots, but he's firing in the wrong direction. He's just backed away. Now the Persian dude's going to start climbing up towards the hill. Maybe Fulcrus was counting shots, and so maybe the Persian dude's thinking about pushing over, trying to find an engagement.
As long as he doesn't kill himself again.
Yeah, that was definitely unfortunate. However, what I don't think they're accounting for is having three tanks up on the hill, let alone two. So Mako still has all his shots. They were wondering about a push coming out of high. And,
I'm half Persian. I can say those things.
With Warbander losing most of his HP at this point, HP is still in favor of high, who are defending, so they don't really even have to move that far.
I almost just thought for a moment, and I don't know why, that Exo was just going to come up behind Static and push him off. Because he made the move. I know that obviously wasn't going to happen, but in my mind, I kind of hoped it did. Is that bad? Am I a bad person for thinking that? You're nodding? I am? Okay. All right.
Don't be that guy. They're on another team, by all means. Drive
well, of course, but it just that whole scene that played out in my mind was absolutely hilarious. Ollie the Persian dude is sneaking his way up there, though.
Meanwhile, Blue's actually getting a little bit aggressive there in the middle with that 113, just kind of creeping around down there. And if you look over at the three line, 07 have actually massed up a pretty large amount of their tanks and are taking control of the three line.
And just a fun fact for the day as Feel My Potato takes out Warbander. If, for whatever reason, we go to overtime, not only in this series but the next series coming up, it is going to be mines. Something to think about.
Interesting, especially if these teams playing as slow as this. Gotta wonder if we'll make it that far.
Very incredibly cautious play coming out of both teams here.
Now, what I'd like to see happen right now, and provided this is a bit of an older strat back from the 754 days, once teams could get tanks up on the hill, what they'd start doing is they'd start trying to work tanks out towards the one cap up there where they could get some cap pressure going, and when the other team has to go back to get the resets, they have to drive under those guns up on the hill. Now, it does create some huge isolations, and they have to figure out how to get that tank out of B1 as well as A5 up there. So Rompstar just sitting up there on the new climb that you can get to with the new physics. There's been a lot of those that we've seen this season. However, I don't believe we've actually seen this particular one in the league so far. The Persian dude just climbing around on the hill.
You know, he's been going back and forth deciding whether or not he wants to push up that hill or just leave it alone.
So Romstar sitting up here, this is one of those new boosts I was just talking about, something we haven't really seen a whole lot. Very hard to kill. Batchets don't really have the gun elevation if they're directly under him to shoot up at him. And so he's very hard to dig out there, especially if they make any play towards that one cap. And he obviously has free resets over towards that one cap. He can punish this corner as they come around, and it's only if Romstar happens to misplay it, at which point he'd go down. So So pretty good spot there that can work. However, the rest of the team does need to support him. If they are able to get over towards C4, C5, they would have the elevation to hit him even in bat chats from this sort of range.
Oh, and something to note, 3 minutes and 40 seconds left on the clock here for Team High, or excuse me, for Team 07 to make a move.
And here comes the push out of 07. They make a pretty decisive push up towards D3 with all their autoloaders, and they are going to find Blue Mini.
Shots being taken onto Blue Mini. Is he going to go down here? A lot of focus fire. Meanwhile, Fossa taking quite a bit himself. He's going to try to move away. No, down he goes.
They will trade out Blue Mini, though.
Good trade.
They are trying to force the brawl up on the hill. However, Ali Persian Dude is coming out on top.
Oh, nice shot as he slickly takes out Static. And he is living for now. The problem is Exo still with two shots, and he's going to miss. Push him off. Do what I asked for. No.
He does get the kill, though, and that evens it up. But, well, actually, no, it's still a gun favor.
I almost got the situation that played in my mind. I almost got it.
Meanwhile, Commodore getting caught out by High.
Oh, Robstar taking so much damage, though, in return for Commodore, and he's actually going to go down to Zone Delta. Commodore is going to stay alive.
And it's even back up on guns, 4-4. However, the HP is in favor of High.
HP is definitely in favor of High. And as I say that, it gets even more in favor of High. Mako's here is going to be backing off now. As he is reloading, I believe it. Yep, he is. Meanwhile, Exo is just super healthy on this hill. 5 clips, full HP. It's almost like he's on a vacation right now. Compared to the rest of his team.
And they need to make sure they don't make the same mistakes that Rival made earlier and just waste that full health tank he used to come in.
Zone Delta's going to go down. Meanwhile, Exo is finding shots
he
on the Magenta Panda.
Shot.
Oh, no, he doesn't get the finishing shot, though. Now he's going to switch his focus to Feel My Potato. And down he goes. Mako's making the play.
The problem is besides dealing with these two bat shots, they still have to get a full health grill out of A5.
And on top of that, there's only a minute 30 to work with. They are making progress, but... Oh!
He gets safe, and he gets behind that rock, still expecting the tank up at A5.
Nice shot. Drops the clip immediately. They know 07 does they do not have that much time to work with here.
They need to be careful not to give any HP away to that grill sitting in back. They only have a minute to work with. Mako's has 3 shots, and Exo is reloading right now.
Chroma Trash is about to be loaded, though, in the Tier 9 Bat Chat. He could cause a little too much damage to 07 to really help them claw back into this one. With 45 seconds left, Exo taking a huge shot from Fulcrus in that grill. And now they step over to try to take out. Oh, Permatrash. Had Mako's rolled slightly higher, he could have actually done it. They would have been 2 guns still alive for 07, but unfortunately...
This round is over. There isn't anything Mako's can do at this point, barring an ammo rack, which he does not
I
get.
Mean, even the fact that the grill just missed doesn't matter.
He can't reload.
He's not going to load fast enough.
He can't cap out. There is nothing that Mako's can do at this point. So 07 is taking a little bit too long to make those plays. Would have been interesting if they'd made that push a minute sooner. He might be able to get through a second clip right now and find a way to kill Fulcrus. However, not going to happen. Mako's is going to try to go for the ram. And Fulcrus
just tries to shoot. Respectable, but unfortunately nothing to be done there. And High is going to tie it up 1-1. Again, these two battles that we just witnessed were easily the slowest clips I think I've ever seen. I mean, that one literally went to the 10-minute mark.
I expected some really slow battles, or really fast battles early on today.
So did I. Trust me. Every time I see clips, I get a little excited.
However, just not the case. Both teams opting to play a very slow defense, and both the attacking teams trying to be a little bit cautious. And this kind of has to do with how the meta's evolved, because a lot of these teams have realized they're basically winning or losing their matches with the early plays that they're making. I've called it that the Russian roulette, essentially, of how they open up. What are you going to get? Where's it going to land? And so they've kind of realized, all right, well, this is costing us rounds. So that comes back to that whole conversation earlier I was having on Himmelsdorf during the Apex match about callers, making sure they keep their guns together and making those safe early plays and not giving away stuff for free. Running these plays that they're making, they are very ballsy and very aggressive plays, They're risky. They have a huge amount of risk that goes along with them, and you don't want to have those in your opening plays if you can avoid it. On Cliff, because the map's so small, a lot of teams were willing to do it, but now it's kind of just evolved to where they want to slow it down a little bit and kind of play it out and make sure they keep their guns alive, and that's what we've seen out of both teams so far.
And we see 07, Makos and Exo, the last two tanks as well, alive, definitely doing a healthy bit of damage, but unfortunately it drops off from there with Commodore, Fosta, and then Zone Delta, Static, and Warbander just really not able to get much off. They fall first, and then even High, I mean, not doing too much damage in and of themselves, even though they did win. I mean, Fulcrus, realistically, let me see here. How many shots did he even fire? He actually fired 8 shots, but only found 2 direct hit and 2 pens, so it was definitely a slow game.
Not a lot of easy shots for him back there.
I'm not saying that, you know, obviously he missed because he's bad, but he just wasn't able to find much for him. And the shots that he did land, they did damage.
Yep, a lot of tough shots there. And just because of the angles that 07 played, they understood, all right, there's tanks up here. And so they kind of figured out minimize exactly how much damage he could get off. You know, when they made that push, they pushed all the way up against that rock that cut between him and A5. So they knew, all right, they have a gun up there, so let's just play it safe. And they got into a position where they could take out Blue Mini without that grill being able to get any shots off. And so when you can guarantee that one gun's going to be out of the fight, it's always an advantage for you.
Correct.
So, you know, they did a good job analyzing it there. However, the problem was is they waited just a little bit too long to make that push. Makos couldn't get into a second clip, didn't have enough time to reload to kill that grill at the end there. And we have a tied series 1-1.
Yeah, that's the one thing I do wonder at this point is who indeed is going to be the more aggressive team as this series is prolonged and goes on, because we both predicted a very close game between 07 and High that looks to be the direction that we're heading with both of the teams. I am curious, though, to see who is going to turn it on first and who is going to keep that aggression going, and whether or not that works to the aggressor's advantage is yet to be seen. So,
yeah, so next map will be kind of interesting because it's more of a defensively sided map, even more so than mine's. So if we were hoping these teams
would
be a little bit more aggressive and speed these battles up, we'll have to see. Attacking teams may, you know, try to get overly aggressive to kind of create a play for them, but we'll see if it happens.
Yeah, well, let's head right into it.
Runeberg, a mixed-type map. The defending team starts the battle on the green, and the attacking team starts at the center square of the town. Bases are located quite far from each other. Both bases are better controlled from the village when playing a heavy setup. It's better to attack the first base through the top direction with the help of several well-armored heavy tanks. For the attack on the second base, it's better to use a more mobile setup and either play through the center or split forces. In general, the map is not easy to play on. Teams often use blind shots and risky shifting of the forces from one flank to another.
We're going to head into battle number 3 here, ladies and gentlemen.
So, looking at the lineups here, 2 215Bs, a 113, 250Bs, a T10, and a Batshot AP coming out 407 on defense. Meanwhile, High, a 113, 2 140s, 2 Batshats, a Grill 15, and an AMX 1390. Defense out of 07 is rather interesting. They're sending the T10 up towards A6, so probably play the hole down on the outside. 113 is actually getting very aggressive towards the middle here, and the rest of the tanks are staying up on the zero line where they can cover everybody.
Immediately lit, but as a static.
So they do try to trade shots there. However, Romstar and Static both firing shots off into the dirt. And what they haven't necessarily spotted is the Batshat of Ali the Persian Dude and Permatrash both hanging out in the town still for High. So Static needs to be a little bit careful there, he doesn't get caught out.
And he's going to eat a shot, although not the worst situation. Only 288 going to leave. Never mind, there's another 600 damage total being left from Static's HP pool as he is now slowly backing off. Something to note here, I usually see teams on defense and in fact go for that Delta Village there.
Yeah, they're just holding a hard defense. It's going to be extremely hard for them to get towards that 2-cap with all those guns sitting there. But they do have 6-line control as well. That 113 is a little bit isolated. A solid push out of some Batshats towards A6 could see that 113 go down in its current position. So they just need to be careful he doesn't get isolated out there. However, not a danger as of yet.
All right, well, let's go ahead and check in with 07 and their comms and see how they're doing.
Bats in the middle. You just blind shot me from here.
Q
Camador, join the 113. Join the 113, Camador.
I think he's in that little, what is it called? This thing?
Something just fell on the street. They might be coming to push into my area.
You're fine, Static. I got you.
Never mind. That's just
none of this about here.
Thanks.
We got 140s down here with the grill. We probably just need to go across middle. The 50Bs can look down into middle and kill the bass.
Go on the outside.
You got to wait for the AP to get this way some, so then the heavies can push here to reset.
No idea what are we supposed to do.
Can we get down here? Can we group here?
We're trying to reset from here. We're going to push in into the 113.
R215
AP, you got to go, man. You got to get behind them.
I'm not going to be able to stay in there, so they don't take the village.
You can get
See, there's one
behind them.
The other bat's in the middle. No, he's in the middle.
Can we do this? Can we push?
Dude, we got to go recovering. Oh, now they have two bats out of it. Though.
Go.
Yeah, we got to
push across into the 113.
I'm in the low, by the way, Macros. I'm not with you.
Fine.
Yeah, the 90's gonna be tough to spot. That's the problem.
Stack's pushing into the bat.
140's track. Okay, I'm clipping.
Yeah, that 39's gonna be
140
tough to spot.
From the wrap. Can we get a reset?
Alright, there he is. Nice job, Cam. Nice.
I got the 1390.
Nice. Oh man, as Blue Mini goes down, Ollie the Persian dude also gonna go down. Feel My Potato gonna find a kill onto Commodore. The thing that really got me though was from the comms. I have no idea what we're supposed to do. Really, it was like the perfect moment too, because they were looking for something and they just couldn't find it. So I don't really know what to do.
As a caller, that's one of those just huge facepalm moments. You spent a minute going over, all right, this is what we're gonna do. This is where you're gonna go. And that one kid in the back of the class, what are we doing?
That was perfect indeed. But okay, so here is something though that I, on a more serious side, that I noticed from 07 is there's a lot of information being traded on those comms, and sometimes all that information can kind of be a little overwhelming and honestly just kind of flooding chat.
Yeah, and it's up to the caller to
is maybe why that player got confused. He was just like, well, I don't really know what to do here. What are we doing?
Yep, and it's up to a caller to essentially almost be a traffic controller at some point when it gets that bad, is make sure everyone knows what they're supposed to be doing, kind of unify everything. And so you heard him chime back in and make sure he clarified what each person was supposed to be doing.
Correct.
And overall,
they got a better trade. I mean, look, they're a tank up. Their HP pool's in the advantage. So yeah, you are correct.
Yep, and you got to listen to it. They formulated a plan, and if you listen, they said, all right, we understand that there's these, the 140s are here in the south, and they knew that 113 was there, and so they said, all right, well, these bat shots are probably over here, so let's get the tanks overhead, and let's force in the middle road here. And they knew that those 140s and the grill didn't have shots in the middle road, so they were able to create an overmatch. So once again, they pushed in with some of the tanks, the 113. T10, and I believe it was one of the 215Bs, pushed in there, got the batch hats to where they had to move or they'd die, and that forced them into the 50Bs who were sitting up on top in the Delta Village, had clean shots in the middle road. So all of a sudden you have a situation where there's two tanks get isolated by, five guns, essentially. And look at how the trade looked out in favor of 07.
This is easily in favor of 07, and this is a very tough situation for a high. I mean, they are stacking towards the south there, and you see them at K0. I mean, I don't even really know what they can potentially do here to break this defense, especially the fact that they're a gun down and their HP is not that great.
Yep. And one thing I will say about that whole I don't know what I'm doing comment, just a PSA to all players as well. If you don't know what you're doing legitimately, then say so. Don't be the person that sits back and doesn't say anything when you have no idea what's going on. Ask the caller what you should be doing if they have some sort of a plan. It's when people just kind of go, I don't know what's going on, I'm going to do my own thing.
I'm just going to do my own thing, yeah.
And then you get left out. So, while we are sitting here kind of making fun of it almost, he did the right thing. He made sure, all right, let's make sure that I'm on the same page as the rest of the team.
And then their caller immediately repeated, and look at the trade they got.
Yep. So
heavily
it's
in their favor.
It's time sensitive, but, sometimes you need to do it. So try your best to be paying attention to your caller, but sometimes it doesn't always happen. So
but again,
a little tidbit there.
And then we don't necessarily fault that player either, because there was so much information being traded in that comm.
Yep.
So.
And this looks like to be another match.
This looks like a very difficult situation for high, but yes, another match that is going to go very slowly.
Yeah, both teams, and once again, it comes down from 07, not willing to give up anything. They understand, all right, we have a huge advantage here. There's no reason for us to force anything to possibly throw a match.
This would be their game to throw easily.
Yep, they have no interest in switching professions and becoming baseball players all of a sudden. So Don't want to throw a game.
You've been waiting all night for that one, I think. Well, it was well played, though. I like the placement. Yeah, I mean, what do you do here is high, you know? It's tough.
You have to make a play. You have to have a sign. You have right. to understand that, look, we don't have an advantage. If they give us an easy advantage, we'll take it. But overall, we have to make some sort of a play here. Well,
especially with only 2 minutes and 35 seconds left on the clock.
The way to think about it is you have to understand that, all right, this is a bad situation and it's probably going to be a loss. However, you always want to give yourself the best chance you can of succeeding. You need to find some way to make a play to maybe find a way into it. Is
right.
it going to happen?
And I'm not saying they should give up. This is a very just poor situation they find themselves
in. If you can
in.
Give yourself a 5% chance over a 1% chance, then take the 5% chance. You know, it's that little bit great chance working. It's still a 5% chance to win. Probably won't happen. However, you know, you got to do everything in your power to hopefully play it out and try to pick up a win. If, as you look at it, their push is a unified push onto Warbander, who is isolated.
Yep, and they should be able to take him out here. No, he's going to back off.
The rest of the guns very quickly
moved
in.
Yeah, here comes the rest of the team of 07. They should be able to clean up Magenta and Permatrash, if not Rompstar as well, as he's trying to step in front. Still quite a bit of damage going on to Zone Delta now. And there it is. Magenta Panda is going to fall. And this one is... This is just easily for me to call it. 07 is going to take this one. Yep. XO going to clean up Rompstar. And it is now up to a almost dead Feel My Potato and Focus. And they're gone. So that was... That like was really fun, though.
Like I said, this map tends to be more of a defensively-sided map. Great play there out of 07. I really liked that flex. I liked the thought process that clearly went on there. They identified the two tanks were isolated. They said, all right, let's create this other match. So they got more guns in that one situation, and they did just, you know, what I've been talking about. They found a position where they had more guns in one area,
right,
and the other guns weren't at risk, which is always ideal.
Again, hats off to their caller for digesting all of the information that was being traded in their comms. And then just spitting out a very solid plan to deal with the situation. And it worked. I mean, 100%. The trade was definitely in their favor, and they were able to take the game. So great stuff. Great stuff.
Yep. No, absolutely fantastic.
However, there. That could also come back to bite them, you know, if there is too much information, there's too much comms, and then, you know, you get a situation where you're like, okay, well, what do we do about it?
Yep. Well, deciphering all the information, it can be a hassle. It's crucial. Having information, knowing as much as you can, is super important when it comes to making decisions. The more information you can have is great as long as you know how to decipher it and understand right. what you're hearing. So a lot of these teams, they've been doing this for a while. They're used to playing at a high level. So having a lot of information thrown at them isn't anything new. It may seem like a lot to people that aren't necessarily familiar with how some of these top teams or even in a sense some of the top clans operate out there. And, you know, that's just, you know, one way. There's a lot of comps coming in. And if you notice... There was no random chatter that you so often hear. You know, when casual viewers are just playing, say, Strongholds, for example, if you're involved in some sort of clan, a lot of time you hear a lot of random chit chatter, like, oh, I got a bounce there, or oh, RNG, or they're talking about their favorite TV show.
Generally not.
There's none of that going on. It's all, all right, this tree fell, we know this stuff's going on here. It's all relevant information, and that's something that is very important when it comes down to having good comps, which, you know, the fact that they're able to formulate that plan out of that.
Right, like I said, or especially Comps has said many times in the past, it's business. You know, these teams, they're not playing in the Gold League because they think it's necessarily fun. I mean, I'm sure a lot of them do enjoy it, but at the same time, like this is for a lot of money. This
$325,000
is a huge opportunity to do something, you know, greater than yourself because you're playing with a team. So these guys, yeah, they're not going to be. Oh, hey, did you see the episode of that show last night? Yeah, it was pretty sick. No, they're not going to be doing that. I mean, maybe, sure, like, before the match, if they're just trying to lighten up the mood a little bit. But when the match starts and these tanks are rolling, they're not going to be doing that. And as we see the lineup of high, we're going to actually see 3-1-13s. It's almost like something we see out of Apex.
Come in with...
Here, and that's actually 07, excuse me. It's 3-1-13s for 07, and then a 4-30, two bat chats, and a tier 54 lightweight.
Meanwhile, I am bringing
in 54 lightweight.
2 2-15Bs, an IS-4, a 113, a 50B, and 2 tier 9 bat shots. Blue Mini just taking the passive scout in the south. Bromstar taking a much more aggressive scout in the Delta Village. Fossa and that T-54 Lightweight heading out towards the zero line, trying to get any eyes. And it's actually going to be the heavy tank of Permatrash. It's just going to push down there and get into that bottom corner to open up all of that. Meanwhile, Feel My Potato just firing off a blind shot down south, trying to see if there's anything just sitting down there in one of the bushes. Doesn't get a connection, though.
And as we've seen before, of course, on Runeberg, we often see the Delta Village being taken control of as the defense, but wow, shots coming on a Permatrash.
And if you'll note there, looking at the bottom, he has a repair kit, a fire extinguisher, and rations, so opting not to run a health kit. So if he loses a crew member, that's going to be it for that crew member for the rest of the game.
And a bounce coming off the front plate. Not finding much. He is dug in down there.
The HE
shell.
But
it's not really working. He's taking a lot of fire.
Well, it's going to be take him a long time to kill it. Shell actually hitting the gun barrel. And I like this out of 07. They're playing, because they're sitting so far back, they actually have a little bit of an angle on that tank down there. And they're just sitting here and they're shooting him with HE. They're not even shooting him with regular shells. They're saying, all right, we know that we're not going to find an angle where we can penetrate you, so let's just spam whatever we can at you. So they're just throwing all these HE shells there and just slowly chipping them down. Well, it doesn't seem like a lot.
It's a very intelligent play.
Well, it doesn't seem like a lot. You know, 20 HP at a time, death by paper cuts. Kind of get worked down, and eventually he'll either drop or be low enough that when they push, they can take him out in just a shot or two. And as I say that, if you look right now, he is already down down his gunner.
Yep. And which, again, he does not have a health kit.
Yep, and his gun's damaged as well. He did take one shot to his gun earlier, and he's actually going to have... He's trying to pull forward, trying to see if he can use that building as cover, and he just takes more damage.
What an intelligent play from 07. I really like this from them.
Yep, it's a solid counter to that position. They clearly set up for it. They said, all right, these guys tend to do this a lot. Let's see what we can do. Now he's going to try to back out. He'll be safe right now, and then there's one spot where he's going to cross where he'll be kind of exposed. He's actually just going to reposition. The funny thing is, over in that corner, and he still can get shot from right there. So very good out of 07. They still have the shots. I want to know how many HE shells they all brought. Because if this was a game, normally teams only bring like
a few.
Yeah, like 2-3 HE shells a game. Some people bring more in some of the bigger tanks, but there really isn't a reason to want their team to bring a whole lot of it. So if they knew this was a possibility from the get-go, I'm really curious to see what their ammo loadout was like. And that 113 doesn't carry a whole lot of ammo to begin with.
That's true. But again, I gotta say, I really like this 07 that I'm seeing. Fulcrus gonna find Fosta. That could have potentially... we didn't see it. They could have him potentially been going for the kill onto Permatrash on that crossfire. I'm not sure, but that is that's a misuse almost of a T-54 lightweight there.
There, I think, to note, very quietly, that both the Bat Chats are just chilling out here at B1 for the side of 07. Now, they're not moving, but you can see them there on the mini-map. They're just sitting there waiting for some sort of play, so I kind of wonder what the signal is for them to kind of push in right now. There is just under 6 minutes left on the clock, so they still have plenty of time. And they may actually catch Blue Mini out here as he's making a cross towards that
A5. That would be huge, but they don't.
Neither of them have their gun in the position looking for him. Not quite sure what they were looking for, and that's going to completely throw off this push.
Blue Mini is in a very good spot now.
And Ali the Persian
to receive
dude
this, as is
getting shot in the side there.
Oh, I was going to say, as is with Ali the Persian dude, finding a good angle with Blue Mini to hold that push. They're down the A or B line, but he took quite a considerable amount of damage in that IS-4. Now, although 07 is... with the HP pool advantage, they are down a gun. However, Permatrash is on his way out, and Ali the Persian dude took about half his HP and damage as well. So, I mean, this is, for me, a dead even game.
And Blue Mini getting caught out trying to run.
Nice
Exo will find some
Exo
shots.
And can Zone Delta come in to clean it up? Or no, Exo's going to try to do it by himself. Can he find that last shot? I don't think he has it. And that is exactly what you were talking about. Exo realizing that he's about to be playing a little more slow, not too much action, drops his three round clip.
Yep, and he still has the other bat chat there to cover him, so knows he's not in danger of them pushing back. And because he only fired two...
When you play an autoloader, you have to know when you should or should not drop your clip.
Yep, and now here's the thing, is now he's going to be fully loaded, so when they want to make this push, which I have a feeling is going to come as soon as he's off that reload, they'll have both have their full clips to deal with a very low HP IS-4 and a one-shot bat.
One-shot bat, yeah.
So Blue Mini is going to sit there passive, and here comes the push out of both teams. The 113 is rolling towards the middle. The Bat Chat's going straight up, and they're not even spotted yet.
Oh, no. This is going to be a disgusting overmatch for the team of 07. They are going to get it. Blue Mini is going to fall down. Zone Delta coming around the corner with Exo. Ali, the Persian dude, should go down in just a moment here to those two Bat Chats. And right now, 07 finding themselves in a very advantageous situation, playing so well, but Commodore is taking quite a bit of damage here from the team of High, as it was Fulcrus, and I believe it was also Feel My Potato that got the shots off.
Yep, and I actually like this out of 07. They pushed around on the underside once the Bat Chats got up into 8, and all of a sudden the Bat Chats are in a position to support their heavy tanks. So it went from the heavy tanks supporting the mediums to the mediums now supporting the heavy tanks after they cleared out that top A6 village.
Yeah, and I mean, 07 could realistically, if they wanted to, just go back with those two bat shots or even just one and sit on cap pressure or the one cap. So
problem is there's not a whole lot of time. They only have 3 minutes left, and 07, or not 07, but High still have 5 guns left, and Makos is a one-shotter.
All right, Magenta Panda is caught in the middle here of that Def Lady. He should be going down fairly soon. Shots coming out of Exo, Commodore. And there he goes, Warbander finding the kill shot in the 113. Staticking all, trying to find shots. Taking damage himself.
Feel My Potato getting focused out along with Romstar.
What a cleanup job by the team of 07. This is very impressive and dominating play.
And I like that overall from 07. They slowed it down. It looked like they had some hard intel on High. They understood, you know, looking at some of their previous matches, what their tendencies were. They knew that they tended to push a 113 down that zero line. They got the free damage on him. You know, took him a minute, but they managed to work
him down. Oh,
they rendered
him useless. Within a minute and a half, that tank was pretty much not on the field anymore.
Exactly. And then so once he was down, then they flexed those tanks around up north. They pushed those IS-6s up the, not IS-6s, the 113s up the 6th line
right,
is what I was going
and
for.
And they had the both bat chats going up down the A line, and that's when they took out Ali the Persian doing the IS-4. I believe it was Blue Mini in the bat chat tier 9.
Yeah,
yes.
So they got focused out by those two bat chats. So, very decisive play out of 07.
Yeah.
They had a clear game plan.
This is a refreshing 07 to see, and
yep.
I like this.
Now it would have been interesting to see what would have happened if High didn't run what they normally ran, because that was a very... What I'm saying is that it felt like 07 had a very clear counter plan to what High had typically been doing, and if High had kind of changed it up, it may have gone differently.
And just looking at the damage, the first top 6 slots, all to 07.
Yeah,
Great stuff.
Absolutely, and the next map we have should be rather interesting as well. 07 could close out the series on the next map. It is 3-1. And you know, looking at it though, just 6 of the top 7 players, Zone Delta, Static, Exo, Makos, Warbander, Commodore, all putting up 2,000 to 3,000 damage. And then Fosta in that T54 lightweight, he got focused out early, but he was doing a good job harassing the rest of High, so, you know, probably worth it. And just looking at the damage, Primatrash only able to do 833, not really able to get off a whole lot of shots. He fired 12, so he got off a lot of shots, but there just weren't any quality shots. And just not a whole lot coming out of High there that, really showed any sort of promise, and I really do like that out of 07. It was a great play.
Yeah, absolutely. And they showed that they are here to play in the second round robin so far. Now, of course, High is not to be counted out just quite yet. Still a team that did fairly well in the first round robin. We saw them with some dominating victories as well. So I'm interested to see what they're going to bring to the next map. And again, this is a map you know, I'm just going to say it is mines, so we're going to see mines again, and I'm interested to see what kind of mines we're going to see. We've seen it play pretty much every way there is to play a map. We've seen it aggressive. We've seen it defensive. I don't know.
Yep. So I actually just got an update for the offline score. It is. M60's up 3-2 over Deja Vu.
Okay.
So that's, you know, a battle essentially deciding who gets to go to the offline playoffs almost at this point. It's a little bit early to call it, but, you know,
right, but still,
third versus fourth, so, you know.
And the Quantum 60s are in a better position technically than Deja Vu, so a win over them would be huge because that would mean that they could still compete with Apex and Eclipse to stay in the top two slots.
Yep, and, you know, Deja Vu might have some other plans about that, trying to sneak in that win there so they can take the slot for themselves.
All right, well, let's head right into the next map for 07 and high.
Mines, a small summertime map with lots of hills, rocks, and other cover. The teams start the battle in the usual locations, but the base locations are different. One is located in the bottom part of the village, and the other one is in the water. One of the key objectives is the center hill. That's why the teams will often select fast vehicles and tanks with strong turrets for cover.
What type of mines are we going... Wow, that's a lot of autoloaders.
So looking at 07, coming out here with three bat shots, T-57, TVP, and two Tier 9 bats. Meanwhile, High bringing two 113s, three bat shots, a TVP, and an M40-43. It is 07 on defense, and not too surprisingly, they're running a pretty slow lineup. It looks like their bat shots are actually trying to line up the boost over in the south. And they will get EXO up on the boost. Meanwhile, Static moving out towards the one line. Does get spotted, however, he will be in a pretty good position, relatively safe to get eyes down that one line in the long run.
Now for me, it's going to come down to for Fulcrus. Is this one of those games where he's going to get the consistent lights, where his team can really help him make a difference, or is 07 essentially going to play back, stay hidden, put pressure onto High without even really having to deal with that M40-43,
yep.
Which, I mean, we've seen before. We've seen the Arty be very useful, and then we've seen it be completely useless. So.
Yep, and I actually really like this pick, this T-57, if you think about it. A lot of teams in that sort of position tend to bring an E-100. That's what they've been doing so far. Eclipse, especially, has been bringing that.
True.
And it's a big HP pinata that's kind of hard to chew through. But the thing is once that push comes, it only gets off one shot of damage, essentially, so 750 alpha.
And then it
alpha,
just sits there.
And yeah. Then it just sits there and takes a beating and normally dies before it can fire a second shot. With this T-57, even if he dies, having that first clip, you know, 400 alpha a shot, can pump them all out very quickly. He's going to pump out a lot of damage in that time frame spam before he goes down. You know, so 1,600 damage, and with the rest of the guns there, it's a lot of HP that he can pump out. Now, will he get into a second clip? Probably not, as long as he's the first one focused. If he gets into a second clip, that's going to be even more trouble for High. So I do like the pick there. It makes things rather interesting. And... both these teams just kind of fill each other out. Fosta has a shot from Fulcrus coming right near him, but it lands short against that rock there. Doesn't actually connect. Exo's working up, doing the mountain goat thing up on the hill. Romstar does take a shot of damage over in the village. Or excuse me, over on the one line. Taking a couple shots of damage there. Some good trades coming out of 07.
Yeah, Romstar taking quite a bit of damage. Well, the thing I like about EXO being where he is he's kind of stopping the bat shot or the solo climb up for offense, as we always see right around F0 and G0. That solo climb we see so often just kind of get to have their way with the other team as far as vision and shots go, but Ali, the Persian dude, is taking damage right now as he even tries to kind of hold that angle. And then if he does get up there, EXO is just waiting for him.
Oh, and the push is coming out of here out of 07. This is a great response. They've masked up. Now we'll have to see if they take the hill or they go for the overmatch on those bat shots. My guess is they will take this moment to take the hill. And that's what they're going to do. They will find the overmatch on these 113s, only the TVP supporting them.
You gotta hope that M40-43 for the team of High is gonna do some work for them. The Static starts taking some damage. Blue Mini is now completely overmatched. All these shots coming into his tank. He is going to go down. And it's gonna be Static that picks up the kill. Static, meanwhile, has taken quite a bit of damage, 1337, and he should go down in just a moment. Or is he gonna live?
Artillery tried to get him down. hit him for quite a bit. However, most of that damage was taken during that initial push. And now the Batshats for Hire scrambling to find kills.
Feel My Potato falls to Exo, though, who is also boosted. So, excuse me, solo climbed. Or no, he was boosted, I believe.
Yeah, Exo was boosted by Fossa.
Yes.
You can do it solo. However, what a lot of teams have been doing is they've been using two tanks just to make sure it happens, that they're not stuck down on the low ground.
Static and Makos, though, are both extremely low on HP. One shot for Static, and he is going to fall. Warbander's actually going to come in and try to support. And he is fully loaded in that TVP. He should be able to find Magenta Panda, but he's going to fire a shot off and miss. And now he's taking damage himself. Makos has to take out the tank. Commodore is going to help him out. Magenta Panda could have done a lot of damage if his clip actually had reloaded. And just like that, 07, what a presence of mind to recognize that they have the overmatch. They could push over that hill. And they're going to lead the series 4-1 now over Hive. This is quite an incredible 07 we're watching right now.
This is a night and day difference from the 07 of the first half of this season. And, you know, it's something
Absolutely.
They did very well during Ruinbrig as well. They identified an overmatch. They took advantage of it. They said, all right, well, we know these Batshats are out here. That T-57 was having shots fired at them. And they knew that they had spotted Romstar out on the one line who was taking damage from Static.
Right.
So they grouped up as many of the tanks as they could. They said, all right, these 113s and made a TVP are here. They had five tanks where they had three. They got the free kills. Those Batshats with all the burst were just able to knock down Blue Mini very fast, even
yep.
with that TVP pumping out shots. And they just they cleaned off the hill. They took it over. And from that point, it was a landslide victory in their favor.
Yeah, it was. I mean, they made it look very easy, but their strategy was very bold. But it worked. And the reason it worked is because of the information that they had gathered there. And as you see here, I mean, the top... top five spots here all go to 07 out of the top seven, and it's Commodore actually coming through with 2,200, and then Static and Exo. Very even spread, though, throughout 07. I really like this. Permatrash trying to find some damage, doing the most in his team, 2,200, and then it drastically falls off. Let's Feel My Potato, Blue Mini, Romstar, Fulcrus, and Ali, the Persian dude, round out the bottom with sub 1k damage.
Yeah. Fulcrus's only shot was that 400 damage shot onto Static at the end there after he took taking a lot of damage
right.
already.
Wasn't able to
Not
take
really
out,
able
yep.
to do a whole lot. You know, but overall, it's very consistent. And this comes down, you know, when we were listening to our comms during the last time. If you notice all the information they gathered, it was the same thing here. They heard Art of the 57 said, all right, these Batshats shooting at us. Or I'm assuming, we didn't hear it, but assuming. The 57 goes, all right, I'm taking shots from this Batshat over here on the zero line. At the same time, Static's going, all right, this Batshat's over here. Put three into him. Put four into him. He's almost out. At that point, the caller goes, all right, drop clips, guys. Get ready to push towards the hill. They pushed over there. They knew they had made Romstar back off because he had taken so much damage. So he
right.
didn't have clean vision down the one line or down the three line for that matter. And so they were able to move out of the one line completely unspotted. They got towards the hill, and they got that overmatch.
And just a heads up, Aquatic M60s versus Deja Vu is currently tied 3-3.
So not over yet. Deja Vu still putting up a fight.
I got to say, coming straight out of silver, Deja Vu has done very well for themselves.
Yeah, no.
And they're continuing to do well.
Like we've said before, they're kind of a mini Eclipse.
Yep.
Same thing. They win silver last season.
Well, yeah. And we say that too. I kind of think we say that too much. It's not that they're like a small Eclipse. It's just they're following very closely in Eclipse's footsteps.
Yep. Now, their start in the Gold League has been a little bit stronger than Eclipse's was. Eclipse has had some rough early rounds, but overall, I do like it out of Deja Vu. However, we're back to this battle right now. 07 bringing three Batshats, a 113, TVP, and an RE251.
Uh-huh. Then we have High with a 113, two Batshats, four Batshats, TVP, and then a 251 themselves. So, interesting to see. Out of 07, we see a 113, two TVPs, two Batshats, a T10, and a Tier 9 Batshat. So, again, what I've noticed is when we first kind of saw Mines at the start of the season, there would definitely be at least one to three maybe Batshats, but now this has been an auto-loader-centric map ever since the season has started with the new meta and the new format.
It's always been a pretty auto-loader-heavy map. Back in the days of 742, a long time ago, we saw a lot of 1390s and a lot of T69s before their heat shells were nerfed. The T69 used to have heat shells. They used to have something absurd like a 300-something penetration on a Tier 8.
Wow.
And so they would just dice up IS-3s and other stuff. Then those got nerfed, so we didn't see as many of those.
That's nuts.
But then we still saw a lot of 5100s and 1390s. And then moving on to the Tier 10 format, we didn't really see a whole lot of Batshats early on. We did out of the other regions, but once again, North America had that two-tank limit. We called the Noah's Ark rule, where they could only bring two of the same tank. And so that kind of caused teams to kind of spread out. You know, you only have two Tier 10 autoloaders, so you can't bring a whole lot. We did obviously have the T22 last season, though, before it was nerfed, so we saw a lot of T22s in the teams. One of the teams actually told me last season, if you're not bringing two T22s, you're doing it wrong on pretty much any map. So that was kind of just the meta.
By the way, I just got the whole Noah's Ark reference, and I felt really good about myself, so I wanted to share it. It's Noah's Ark because two animals per species.
Yep, there you go. And so they had,
I'm smart.
So that was only a rule that North America had. I was...
Whoa, fast! That just charges.
Trying to get out of the map there. And hit that red line fast enough, break the barrier, go on. Some Back to the Future stuff
Fortunately,
there.
Fortunately, that doesn't do damage. Otherwise, if that was a rock or something else, Fossa probably would have taken a little bit of damage.
Yeah, or another tank at least. I don't think a rock would have done damage to that speed going flat. However, Exo should get the boost, hopefully. Does he get it? And he falls short, not able to get all the way up there. But to finish, I was saying, that was a rule that North America only had last season. But now that all the rule sets are unified, we're... Everyone in all the regions essentially have the same rule set, is what I was getting at.
Yeah, if they wanted to, they could all bring, you know, F-40-43. It's not that they ever would, but the point is they can.
They could. Yep. And so on maps like Mines and Cliff, having a lot of bursts to be able to knock down a very fast push early is important. Doesn't quite get it. So what tends to happen is on those sort of maps, the plays come very early. Aggressive pushes through the middle, or even just a stalled out push, and because there's a lot of cover, they can sneak up on them real quickly and just kind of time those pushes at any point in the round. And so teams decide they want to go with a lot of autoloaders and a lot of bursts, just so when they do make that early push, they can pump out a lot of damage. But the defense then also goes, all right, well, we're making this early push. We need to knock guns down quickly, so let's bring a lot of autoloaders. So when that first tank comes around, you know, we all fire a volley, but then we all have four more shots to follow it up with. So it's just kind of how the meta's evolved on those maps. They've always been pretty autoloader heavy. Last season, like I said, we saw a lot of T-22s and 140s, and even some E-50s at one point for a little while.
I think that is the third or fourth time Exo has missed that.
And I think keep an eye on is they've wasted 4 minutes essentially at this point trying to get up there, and they are no closer to having tank up there than they were when they started. So maybe they need to find a plan B here. It is 07's match to lose at this point. They are attacking. If they don't get it, they move on to another map, and they will actually be defending first on our fourth map. So
interesting. Okay.
I would definitely favor them in that situation as well. Exo actually takes a bit of damage, but he finally gets the boost done.
It's gotta feel good.
Only 5.5 minutes left, though, and they know he's up here.
Oh, so hopefully Exo really does come through for his team there and make that position really work. For 07, his shots are being found on the Magenta Panda from Zo Delta, and he's actually gonna drop the clip. He took, I believe, every shot he had.
Meanwhile, Exo finally getting up here. Obviously not the most seasoned mountain goat, no Canadian impact, but
or
does
Dumbo for that matter.
Yeah, but he does finally get up here. He does get lit, though, and now it's going to be up to the rest of 07 to kind of figure out what they want to do. It does look like they're staging up to make a 7-line play. We've seen very similar plays out of Apex, like we were just talking about. They get a tank up there, and he can really make those tanks on the J and K line back off, and they can make some sort of decisive push down the 7-8 line here and get into that base and be established. Normally what happens is they try to push down there, and because they don't have any of their guns backing them off, they just take too much damage to make that initial push. It doesn't really work in the long run. Meanwhile, Blue Mini does take a shot at Makos, and actually
yeah,
they're
going to
ignore those tanks in the base, and they're going to head for those for the 113
all
and
right,
the Batchat.
Again, another situation where 07 has realized that they have an overmatch, and they're going to go for a Feel My Potato, taking a lot of damage. Makos, meanwhile, has not taken any damage. No, none of the tanks from 07, really, aside from Exo on top of the hill there in the boost.
just damage on damage on damage going every which way. And it's a back and forth game. One tank down.
Fulcrus
two tanks down for Makos,
and Commodore gonna trade out Magenta Panda. Fulcrus now in the eyes of fire here needs to get out of there. Fosta taking quite a bit of damage. Zone Delta actually just reloaded. Ali the Persian who tried to get away. Fires off a shot and misses.
And now here's the thing, is that second clip, all these bat chats have to reload. This is the downside to bringing this many autoloaders. Can Warbander find a shot? He does put his last shot into Romstar.
Romstar, very low. Ali the Persian Jude is one shot away. Permatrash, the only tank left. Static going to take out Romstar. Permatrash, the only one left with full HP, and it is a TVP still reloading. And unless 07 decides that they want to throw this one away. Oh, what a flick onto Ali the Persian Dude from EXO. Permatrash, the last tank left. And boy, what a performance 07 has put up for us tonight.